John Deere is the world's largest producer of agricultural equipment and a leading manufacturer in the construction, forestry, and lawn care industries. Company-owned and affiliated factories in 11 countries manufacture products for sale in more than 160 countries. But the company is guided today, as it has been since 1837, by John Deere's personal commitment to product quality, customer service, and business integrity. Deere is the global market leader and the best recognized brand in the agricultural equipment business, and it got there by providing customers with genuine value in premium quality equipment and the best customer service with the most professional dealers. The company's beginnings can be traced to this blacksmith shop in Illinois. It was here in 1837 that John Deere forged the first self-scrubbing steel plow. His innovative plow design worked better in the sticky prairie soil than the cast iron plows of the day, and it was this product that led to large-scale farming in the fertile Midwestern prairies. His innovation might have been just a footnote in history, but John Deere went on to forge a way of doing business that remains central to the company today. He was committed to the creation and manufacture of farm equipment that helped farmers achieve greater productivity. He insisted on quality, and he stood behind the equipment he made, stressing the importance of fair dealing with all who came in contact with his company. From these simple beginnings, Deere & Company has grown into a global corporation, operating in all 24 time zones and more than 50 currencies and languages. Deere is a multinational firm with manufacturing joint ventures or assembly operations on every continent. Parts and components are shipped globally and utilized in the manufacture of original equipment in locations where the highest volume of such equipment is used. Yet the most impressive accomplishment of this American success story is Deere's ability to adapt and grow over its 160-year history, despite industrial downturns, worldwide turbulence, and fierce competition in its core business. Deere & Company represents a textbook example of how a company must continually adapt to environmental change through major shifts in corporate and marketing strategy in order to survive and prosper. The strategic planning process always begins with an analysis of the market and customer needs. For Deere's core business, agricultural equipment, this means developing estimates of demand for farm machinery and parts worldwide and identifying customer needs for new technology, product improvements, and service. Based on this knowledge, a marketing strategy is formulated which identifies specific customer targets and a set of marketing decisions based on the four P's: product, price, place, and promotion, which comprise the marketing mix. The marketing mix decisions are considered to be controllable variables under the control of marketing managers, in that price, product, place, and promotion strategies can be changed through decision processes within the organization. Environmental variables are not under the control of marketing decision makers and will constrain their choices with respect to marketing strategies. The optimal strategy choices are those which can achieve the objectives of the firm, take advantage of the organization's resource strengths, and reflect adaptation to important environments: the political and legal environments, the competitive environment, and the socio-cultural environment. The essence of strategic planning is to make decisions which build upon the organization's strengths, mitigate its weaknesses, capitalize on market opportunities, and reduce exposure to environmental threats. To do this, organizations conduct a SWOT analysis, which provides the information upon which sound marketing decisions can be made. Deere & Company demonstrated its ability to adapt and survive adverse economic and political environmental changes throughout the 80s. After a period of record sales and profits in the 70s, the favorable economic and political environments for Deere's core business, agricultural equipment, abruptly changed, presenting Deere with a challenge just to survive. The 70s were years of bonanza for farm equipment companies because farmers were doing well during that period. Worldwide demand for grain was extremely high. Grain prices were high. Export trade was brisk. Farmers were making good profits, and it looked like agriculture was the place to be. But the economic and political environment shifted abruptly in 1979 when President Carter put into effect an embargo that stopped all grain shipments to the Soviet Union and its satellite countries. But the Soviets made up for the shortage by increasing purchases from Australia and Argentina. The effect on North American farmers was devastating, shutting them out of the world market, reducing their incomes at a time when they were highly leveraged, and starting a chain of farm bankruptcies, which by the end of the decade resulted in the collapse of the rural banking system and further farm consolidation. A second blow to farm equipment sales came in 1983 when the U.S. government introduced its PIK, or Payment in Kind, subsidy program. In order to reduce agricultural surpluses, farmers were paid to lower their production by setting aside part of their acreage. This reduction in planted acres reduced demand for farm machinery and demand for parts and service, since farmers were using their equipment less. Deere & Company responded to this crisis by building on their strengths in product innovation and distribution through its John Deere dealer network. R&D investments in product improvement and capital investment in manufacturing equipment and processes resulted in improved product quality and significant cost reduction. They also expanded their financial services, which provided the company with growth opportunities and synergistic benefits. John Deere Credit, one of the oldest suppliers of credit to agriculture, added commercial, consumer, and international divisions, and is now one of the largest finance operations in North America. During a time when economic and political upheaval forced many farmers and International Harvester, a large competitor, out of business, Deere remained financially sound. Deere was able to offer superior products, credit, and dealer service at a fair price in these difficult times. It was also during the 80s that Deere further developed its lawn and garden equipment business. Building on its reputation for quality agricultural equipment and a superior dealer network, Deere began to build its consumer business through product development and promotion. The ability to identify and respond to changes in the cultural and social environment has been a factor in the longevity and success of Deere & Company. In the century and a half since John Deere founded this company, America has changed from a largely rural economy, where 90% of the population were involved in farming, to an urban society in which only 2% are involved in agriculture. One way the company adapted to this shift in demographics and lifestyle changes was by entering the lawn and grounds care business in the 1960s. By the 1990s, opportunities to grow this consumer business have become increasingly attractive. Significant shifts in demographic, cultural, and social forces have changed the market for lawn and gardening power equipment. These include an older but active population with increased interest in gardening as a hobby, dual-income families with more money but less time to landscape their yard, willingness to outsource lawn services to professionals, a quality and service-conscious consumer. Deere & Company has responded to this market opportunity.
We began about 2 years ago with a commitment to doubling the size of the business in commercial and consumer products. We began building factories and putting new resources on board, including hiring people. Our primary goals are to grow the business, almost doubling our sales by the year 2000.
Whether it's Iowa corn, California rice, or Louisiana cotton, John Deere knows a thing or two about harvesting. So for a change, we decided to have our engineers make something disappear After all, somebody had to get mulching right. Introducing the Freedom Mulching System. While some may be impressed by its patents, we think you'll like the way it works, even on wet grass and leaves. Because although the problem was different, the name is still the same.
I never thought when my son moved away that I wouldn't see him for 3 years. Even my dad used to say farmers don't get vacations. But this is one trip I wasn't going to miss. It's just a tractor for my grandson.
How old?
6 weeks. He'll play with it when he's older. Every father hopes his son follows in his footsteps. But farming's not easy. The green and yellow means it's a John Deere. My grandfather had one of these.
He's sleeping.
I brought this for when he's older.
It was so different seeing how my son had built his own life.
Hey, Dad, I gotta show you something.
He got a John Deere.
Of course.
But it was nice to know he could still appreciate where he came from.
Introducing the LT-133 from John Deere. At under $2,000, it's possibly the best lawn tractor ever built. And it's the only one with a past as bright as its future.
Capitalizing on the popularity of golf, Deere recently struck a deal to become the official golf course equipment supplier of the PGA Tour, an arrangement that will showcase Deere's products and brand in a prestigious, quality-oriented environment.
One of the things that sets the PGA Tour apart from other tours around the world is the conditioning of our golf courses. Consequently, we're delighted that we're going to be able to enter into an arrangement where we can utilize the state-of-the-art technology equipment made available by John Deere at all of our clubs, at all the TPCs, which will say to the nation and the world that this is what you can do when you use John Deere equipment.
Teaming up with NASCAR is another indication of Deere's responsiveness to the social and cultural environment, an effective means of reinforcing the John Deere brand and logo as one of quality, performance, teamwork, and support. In the early 90s, as the recession in its agricultural equipment business continued to pound sales, and competition from Caterpillar in the construction industry also hurt, Deere looked to diversification. In 1991, Deere had a loss of $20 million versus 1950 profits of $411 million. Sales slumped 11%. In response, Deere & Company stepped up its push into insurance and healthcare by leveraging its presence in rural America and extending its health maintenance organization to serve non-employees. John Deere Healthcare serves over 400,000 members and has been profitable during all but 1 year since its inception. Yet nothing illustrates the volatility of Deere's environment more than the activities of the 1990s. The first part of the decade saw a decline in the demand for agricultural equipment, followed by 5 years of record sales and earnings. It was an unprecedented period of growth for Deere's core business, thanks to a favorable economic and political environment that fueled demand for agricultural equipment worldwide. Demand for equipment was booming in the mid-1990s. Lower interest rates, aging equipment, rising farm income, and increased acreage under cultivation resulting from the impact of the 1996 Farm Act all provided a positive impact for Deere's sales. However, another downturn in the agricultural business cycle began in late 1998 with projections of 15 to 20% declines in the sale of agricultural equipment for the latter years of the decade. Deere prepared itself by creating a more diverse offering of goods and services, broadening its marketing capabilities to the construction, lawn care, and financial services sectors, as well as continuing improving its core business. Environmental regulations regarding soil erosion, engine exhaust emissions, and water pollution caused by agricultural runoff have compelled U.S. farmers into new practices and products for conservation tillage and precision agriculture. Precision farming is the newest innovation in U.S. agriculture. It uses computerized equipment and satellite technology that allows precise quantity and placement of inputs such as fertilizer, seed, and pesticides. In the U.S. and Western Europe, farmers harvest crops in air-conditioned comfort with the same navigation technology used by yachts or planes. Farmer Ken Dahlenberg drives a combine using a global positioning satellite receiver to pinpoint which patch of ground he is working while the combine keeps track of grain yields. When he crunches that data with seed and fertilizer records, he can tell which plots need improvement. These farmers and others in developed countries want the latest in technology and comfort, even if the cost is substantial. Exports will continue to be an essential component of U.S. farm machinery shipments. U.S. exports of farm equipment rose by 43.3% from 1992 to 1995. The top five U.S. export markets account for close to 60% of total exports. These are, in descending order, Canada, Australia, Mexico, Germany, and France. Argentina is the most dynamic upcoming export market. But continued tariff reductions under the World Trade Organization agreements, which took effect January 1, 1995, should increase the price competitiveness of U.S. machinery. Also, demand for better diets in developing countries should lead to increased mechanization of agriculture. In particular, agriculture in China continues to change as its population demands a better diet and more people abandon agriculture as an occupation. These factors should create the need for larger farms, increased mechanization, and greater opportunities for Deere & Company. Throughout its rich history, Deere & Company has grown and prospered as it has responded to an ever-changing global environment, a complex collage of economic, political, competitive, socio-cultural, and technological forces. That's why they can still say, after more than 160 years, nothing runs like a Deere.